Good evening, Round Rock ISD community. Thanks so much to all of you who are joining us. I think we have about 350 folks joining us tonight, so we appreciate it. This is our second round of town halls related to COVID issues. So again, thanks for joining us. Tonight, we are going to be focused on health and safety protocols that we've put in place on our campuses and our district facilities. So that's the topic. So we ask that if the questions can please center on that. We've assembled some subject matter experts to help answer those questions. But I do want to tell you, we have two other town halls coming up. You can find information on our website. Next week, Monday, January 25th, we'll focus on teaching and learning, very specifically what our virtual platform looks like, our on-campus learning, how those are integrated together. And so issues related to that. And then Tuesday, January 26th, we'll be focusing on athletics and fine arts, safety protocols that we put in place there to do everything we can to keep our students as safe as possible, while also being able to participate in those activities that we know are so important, particularly right now. So again, this video will be available on our website. So if you have friends or neighbors who wanted to watch this but couldn't join us, it will be available on our website later this evening. And then as soon as possible, we'll be providing closed captioning both in English and Spanish. We hope to have that done very soon. So those will be available on our website. The way it's going to work tonight, we have a short presentation we'll go over, but we want to reserve as much time as possible for your questions. And if you look at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a Q&A there. If you click on that, you'll be able to ask questions that way. I'll read those questions and then we'll have our panelists address them. We might not be able to get to all of them. Some of them might not be something that can be answered by someone on this panel, but please know that we're going to capture all of those questions. We really use those to inform our communication to see if maybe there's a hole somewhere we're not communicating appropriately, to update our FAQs, but we will get to as many of them as possible. Know that I might group some together if I see several questions kind of on one theme, so it might not be worded exactly as you'd written it, or it might. I might read it directly, so just so you know that's the function to use to ask a question. I want to thank our interpreters tonight. We have Amanda and JC who are signing for us tonight, and they will be switching off, so we'll make sure to pin those videos during the presentation so that you can see that. And so now I'm just going to kick it off by introducing our acting superintendent, Dr. Daniel Presley, and he'll get us started.
Thank you, Jenny. I appreciate everybody joining us tonight for this important information. Also want to thank Trustee Harrison for being on the call. So Ms. Harrison, thank you for being here tonight. So as everybody knows, this has been a really complicated journey since last March. And we're doing our best to try to meet the needs of our community, our students and staff. Safety is our highest priority, and that's why from this town hall, we put our safety protocols and discussion of what we're doing to keep everybody safe as a topic for tonight. So with that, I'll turn it over to Sharon Wilkes, who will do our presentation, and we'll definitely take questions as they come in from the community. So thank everybody for joining us.
And Sharon, before you get started, I apologize. Let me just quickly let everyone know who we do have on the call. Sharon Wilkes will be kicking us off. Sharon is our Area Director of Academics for the Round Rock Learning Community, but she has taken on this very important role of COVID coordinator for the district. She has been absolutely amazing, and she works hand in hand with Brandy Hafner, who you also see on your screen, our Director of Health Services. And they really are our COVID czars in this, so we appreciate them. Tanya Davis, our Director of Benefits, is on the call as well. Ruben Dominguez, our Director of Custodial Management. And then we also have two of our area superintendents, John Yonker from the McNeil Learning Community and Becky Donald from the Westwood Learning Community. And then also we do want to thank our trustee Tiffany Harrison for joining us tonight as well. So those are the experts you see in front of you. And with that, I'm going to let Sharon go ahead and start with our short presentation.
Great. Thank you. All right, so we're pulling that up. All right. So we're excited to be here this evening. And Brandy and I have been doing much work regarding the COVID guidelines. And so it was really a very beneficial thing for us to be able to share this with you and kind of share some of our thinking. So I wanted to start first with our Round Rock ISD Reimagining Education website and share with you that there is a lot of great information on that site, including the COVID-19 health and safety protocols, as well as the COVID-19 dashboard information that I'm going to be referencing. I'd like to talk to you a little bit tonight about what we're doing and have been doing to mitigate the coronavirus in the district and on our campuses. We have asked our students and staff to screen themselves daily. We have limited people coming into our campuses to only essential visitors. We have mask protocols in place. And the Center for Disease Control states that masks are a critical step to help prevent people from getting and spreading COVID-19. So we provided masks and face shields to all of our students and staff. We also provided desk shields for all of our elementary students. And we provided hand sanitizer and classroom cleaning supplies in each of our classrooms. We also have cleaning protocols in place. Our custodial teams use disinfectants that meet the EPA's criteria for use against SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19. And they have a checklist of high-touch areas that they regularly clean throughout the day. We also have schedules in place to ensure that students are washing their hands, and we provided floor dots and signage to promote social distancing. Anytime a campus has a positive or probable case, this is really about notifications, and we really wanted to make sure that everybody understands, when do we notify people? How do we communicate? And so anytime a campus has a positive or probable case, an email is sent to the entire community via e-news and to the staff group email to notify everyone that there was someone on campus who was either positive or a probable case, which means that they were around someone who was positive and they're exhibiting symptoms. Has to have both of those to be a probable case. So a close contact is defined as a person who was within 6 feet for approximately 15 minutes or more during a 24-hour period, or being directly exposed to infectious secretions of a COVID-19 positive or probable case. We notify all close contacts via telephone and email. So they get notified two ways. And if a person should live in the same household, so they're a close contact of someone in the same household who is positive, they must quarantine for the isolation period of that COVID-19 person, which is 10 days, as well as an additional 14 days, which is the quarantine period for close contact. So this means 10 days for the isolation period of the person living at home, and then the 14-day quarantine period for a total of 24 days, unless the family members can maintain social distance. If the close contact does not live in the household, then the quarantine period is only 14 days. I also want to let you know that we notify all classes and buses and extracurricular teams of any positive or probable case that was involved in their classroom, on their school bus, or on their extracurricular team activity. Those students may not need to quarantine because they may not be close contacts, but we did feel it was important to notify everybody regarding that information. So lots of notifications go out. I'm sure that you've seen many of them yourselves. So if you'll go to the next slide, please. Another one of our communication tools we have in our district is our COVID dashboard. And based on feedback from the community, we changed our COVID dashboard reporting from weekly to daily. So what happens is that campuses notify the district when they receive a positive or a probable case and close contacts. And then the following day, the dashboard is updated at noon. So you won't see it in the morning the following day. You won't see it until noon the following day. So Brandy and I received many questions about the dashboard. And so I just wanted to make sure that it was really clear that I shared that we only report the number of positive or probable cases of on-campus learners or staff members. And to let you know that we only report the number of close contacts to those cases from on-campus learners or on-campus employees. One of the purposes of our dashboard is for parents to be able to make informed decisions. And it is all in regards to what's happening on campus. And this is our way that we can tell them of what's happening on campus. That's why we do that. We're glad that so many families and staff members utilized the district COVID self-reporting button to let us know what was happening over the holidays. It was so well utilized that we're looking into continuing to use it throughout this year. We also continue to report all cases to either the Williamson Counties and Cities Health Department or Austin Public Health during the holiday break. So just know that that continued to get reported even though our kids were not on campus. We still continue to have that communication between our local health authorities and ourselves so that they know. So now I'm going to turn it over to Brandy Hafner, our Director of Health Services, who does an amazing job.
All right, let's look at our next slide. We'll be talking about vaccines. Vaccines are the latest topic nationwide in an exciting way and a very frustrating way. The vaccines do appear to have great efficacy, and we're really thankful that they're rolling out. The hard part, though, is that the state of Texas decided to offer the vaccine to multiple groups of people before the supply was adequate. So they started, you can see here, they started with phase 1A, which includes a group of folks, mostly healthcare workers, first responders, last responders. But there haven't been adequate supplies delivered to this area to even finish vaccinating the people in group 1A when they started to announce that people in 1B could go and get in line. So this has caused a large amount of people to be very upset, but the vaccines just aren't here yet. There are many groups and agencies in this area who've been preparing for this for months and will be ready when the access improves. School districts are not receiving vaccines at this time. The state decides who gets the doses. So right now we're working with our community partners to connect our eligible staff with doses. As more become available, it's our hope to partner with a third-party vendor to have access, to have vaccines available to our staff. Again, this is a plan that's waiting for the supply to be ready. As far as the students go, the current vaccines are approved for individuals that are 16 and over. The drug companies that are developing these vaccines have to go through additional trials to make sure the vaccines are safe for the younger ages. You know, children's immune systems are different than adults, and their immune responses can be different at different ages. So the process can take a while, especially for the younger ages, which is usually who is tested last. A prediction I heard recently was that a full pediatric vaccine might be available by the late 2021. People ask often if this would be required, if we're going to require this of the kiddos in the district. And that's something that the state health department decides. Since pediatric doses haven't gone through the FDA review, we're really far from knowing that info. But I can imagine that it would be similar to other pediatric vaccines where there would be a process for people who don't choose it for their child. If we could go to the next slide, we can talk a little bit about this slide shows how many cases we're seeing in Round Rock ISD. It's not a true incidence rate like the health department calculates. But it features data that we've been collecting on the dashboard since September. And you can see the cases, you know, humming along there for a few months and really start to spike around the holiday times. So we put the little turkey there to show when we had, when we were out of school for the Thanksgiving break. And then the little snowflake there represents when we were out of school for the winter break. So you can see those spikes are not during the times that we were in school. The Round Rock ISD school community is very consistent with the trends that we're seeing nationwide. We're all concerned about the recent rise, and we'll continue to gather data to see where these numbers go. I believe we will have a continue to have a rise in the cases until we have a more significant buy-in from our community about people, how people spend their time when they're not in school. While we have some measure of control to keep kids apart and keep people apart when we're in school, it's really disheartening to see people totally disregard those measures when they walk out of the school. This will no doubt lead to a rise in the cases. We as a community have the power to keep ourselves safer, but it will take a lot of cooperation and a lot of work in together. Anyway, we will continue to gather this data and we'll see where this trend goes from here. I think that's the end of our slide, and we really just wanted to open it up to questions from the community and see what kind of things we could answer for people. Jenny, do you want to?
Yeah, so our first question, what increased safety mitigations are you recommending or implementing, given how much more contagious the current variant is and the drastic increase of positive cases and contact in our schools this past week? And so that question was logged before you started your presentation, but maybe in light of our current circumstances?
Absolutely. So one of the things that we have done a lot of training with our staff. And we have regular meetings, I should tell you, with our COVID campus contacts and our campus nurses. And we have asked all of our people to go back over and review the mitigation strategies with our kids, with our staff members, to ensure that we are really staying with true fidelity to wearing our masks, staying socially distant, because we see it too, and we certainly know that there is an increased amount of close contacts and so on. But what we find is that for the most part, when kids are in school, because we are very stringent with our protocols, they do better when they're in school, meaning that we don't have such a rise in cases. And so we really follow those protocols that the CDC has put into place and has asked us to put into place, which are the social distance, the washing the hands, the cleaning up, the making sure everyone's wearing their mask. Those are all the things that we do our very, very best to ensure that everyone is doing. All staff members and all staff members are doing it with their students. So we have really spent a lot of time reviewing all of this information, making sure that it's really clear, because we're all a little suffering from COVID fatigue. We're all a little tired of it. And it just is a natural thing that people tend to lose their slip on it. And they kind of decide, okay, well, I'm not gonna be as stringent as I was. But we really pushed very, very hard, and we now see that our principals and our teachers are also pushing very hard to ensure that all of those protocols are actually happening. Everything is being put into place as we can.
Jenny, as far as the variants go, there are different variants around the world that are being tracked by scientists, and we're just waiting to find out as the science grows what we can do to improve our efforts to try to fight the variants as the changes come. If it's something different that we need to do from what we're doing, then we will change it. That's something that Sharon and I have learned. You know, she said we train our staff, we meet with them every week, different groups of staff, to make sure the mitigation strategies are put into place and that people have the opportunity to ask questions and really get into it. And what we've learned is this is a fluid thing that changes. And every time the science changes, we always say, when we know better, we do better. So as the science changes and we get more information about the variants, then if our policies need to change, then we will do that.
Great. This is a fairly straightforward question. Are students under 10 required to wear masks?
Yes, they are. We ask all of our students in Round Rock ISD to wear masks. The CDC has said that kids who are 2 and under don't need to wear masks, but all of the students in Round Rock ISD are 3 or older. And so we do ask that all of our students wear a mask.
And I will say, I've actually seen some pre-K classes, and they're doing a great job of that.
And they have the cutest little masks too that we have provided for them as well. So it's really cute.
I have a couple of questions, and I think this is top of mind. Brandy talked about this a bit, about vaccines. One person asked, I'd like to know what the plan is to get all staff vaccinated once it opens up to 1B and the general public. Another asking the status of hosting vaccine clinics for teachers and staff. I know we've made some headway here. We have been able to get some vaccinations for some of our staff, but Brandy or Sharon, would you like to kind of talk about where we are on those efforts, or Dr. Presley as well?
Tanya was going to answer to that. She unmuted. Is that something that you can speak to, Tanya?
We're working on it on a lot of fronts. So
I'm fine with whoever wants to answer. From the employee benefits side, we have worked with our partners. Vaccines are just not available through our partners yet, just because of the way the state has released the vaccines to our frontline workers, the 1A and 1B protocol.
Yeah, I'll add to that. I think we've been relentlessly working with all of our healthcare partners to provide vaccines as soon as possible to our staff who want them. We wouldn't require them to take it, but we had a successful effort, I guess, during the break and after the break to vaccinate our employees 65 and older. And that was with a partnership with Ascension Seton. So we continue to look for any and all options to provide vaccines to staff who want the vaccine.
And we were able to work over the winter break and make sure that our school nurses had the opportunity to receive the vaccine as well. I know Brandy was actually working on Christmas Day to make sure that that opportunity didn't pass us by. But we continue to work with partners, as Dr. Presley said, it's very important. Another question, I would like to know your thoughts on our district continuing extracurricular activities while Austin Public Health advised against it. And we will be talking next week specifically about athletics and fine arts, but I understand the spirit of the question, given some of the things our health experts are saying. Dr. Presley, would you like to talk a little bit about UIL and how those decisions are made?
Yeah, right now UIL is focused on the reduction in fans of the game, folks that are attending the games. So we're in line with that. We're also in a UIL district with teams, our schools from Leander and Hutto is the other UIL that we have in our high school continuum. So we're right now looking at the best approach to reducing fans at games, but trying to continue with all of our sports with middle school and high school athletics as we move forward. So I don't know what else to say other than that, but that's kind of where we are right now. We're moving forward playing sports and checking our kids. Every kid does a self-check before they participate in practice or games every day. And that's kind of where we are.
Anything more about the protocol, Sharon? You want to add the mask wearing unless they're actively participating in sports?
Absolutely. And that is part of the protocol, is that we do ask that they wear masks unless they are, as you said, on the field, so to speak. We also have limited, as Dr. Presley said, the amount of people in the location where we are playing. And that is one of the biggest things, is that we do our very best to limit the people and the players so that we're not crossing different folks from different areas, to make sure that we're keeping it as consistent as we possibly can. In addition to that, our coaches have been provided with protocols to also make sure that they're aware, and they work very hard. Our coaches, our fine arts directors, everybody has been trained on those mitigation strategies that I talked about earlier, and they work really hard to make sure that they are keeping with those mitigation strategies. And so I would say that that goes for band, that goes for choir. They work very, very hard to make sure that they're keeping everybody socially distant.
Thank you. Here's a question about how we sort of identify close contacts. If, for example, a student in a class tests positive, does the entire classroom need to be sent home as close contacts, or only the students who sit near that child or eat lunch near that child?
So it's only those who are identified as close contacts. We follow Williamson County and Austin Public Health in what they determine are close contacts. And close contacts, as I said, are defined as within 6 feet for a 15-minute or greater time period within a 24-hour time period. Or they've had infectious secretions like spitting, coughing, those kinds of things. But we use our adults to identify the close contacts in the classrooms. So if the kids are older, like in high school, then they can help us identify their own close contacts. But when they're young, the teacher is the one who's supervising, and thus they're the ones who identify who those close contacts are. And so they look to see, and they're very good at monitoring who is within 6 feet. Those are the only people who are quarantined, are the close contacts who were within 6 feet. And we always err on the side of caution. I will tell you that we would rather err on the side of caution than not. And so that means that if we're uncertain, but we think maybe they might have been, we go ahead and say they're close contacts, because we would rather the parent be aware and the child or student be notified than to make a mistake.
A follow-up question to that. So when we identify close contact, why aren't their siblings, or why are their siblings still allowed to attend in person? Is there a requirement? Do we let them know, hey, that close contact needs to be isolated at home? How do we deal with that?
So there's a couple of things involved in that. So what you're talking about is that the student was a close contact, but again, per all the local health agencies and the Centers for Disease Control, a close contact of a close contact, I know I'm getting confusing here, but a close contact of a close contact does not need to quarantine, does not need to do anything. Now, should the close contact develop symptoms? That's one of the questions that our nurses and our COVID contacts ask parents, is to notify us immediately if they do develop symptoms, because then we call them a probable case. Remember, a probable case is someone who has symptoms and was in close contact with a positive case. And so then their sibling would be identified as a close contact and they would need to quarantine. So that's a really good question.
So these are the things that Sharon are explaining. You know, I saw a question in the chat. Someone was asking how we determine our policies, because there's different, we straddle two different counties. How do we decide as Roundup ISD what guidance we're going to follow, since we have the two different guidance from the two different counties? And what we do is try to figure out what works best for our community. But what we also do is, like I said, we're not afraid to change it if we think that something better. Last semester is that when we work really hard with the supervising adults of those kids and just excise the kids that were really truly close contacts, the other kids in the class are not converting and they're not affected. So it's something that we would change if we felt like it needed to be changed. And I know it causes a lot of anxiety when someone finds out my kid was in that class, but he wasn't identified. The adults in the classroom are working really nicely with us to try to help us. Only, you know, quarantining a class is a huge responsibility. Sending someone home for 2 weeks is a huge responsibility. It upends people's whole life at home. So we don't do that lightly. We take it very seriously. There's a lot goes into it. We watch videos sometimes. There's lots of different things that go into it. So I just want people to know how much effort goes into identifying these close contacts. It's not done haphazardly.
And just to be clear, when you say watch videos, you mean if we have video in the schools, like in hallways or in cafeterias?
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. So, you know, if there was a case identified on the school bus, that we can pull video from the bus footage, those kind of things. It's almost always bus video. I don't mean to say that we're watching a bunch of video from kiddos during the school day. But if necessary, there are bus videos that we can pull, just to make sure, you know, when we're talking about the adult on the bus identifying who was close to who on the bus, there's seating charts and those kind of things. But oftentimes there's kiddos that don't stay in their seat, etc. So the bus video is very helpful for us in those situations.
Let me be clear, people understood.
Sorry, thank you so much for clearing that.
You're good. So I do want to note that we, in addition to have people joining us live, we also offered folks the opportunity to put a question in a Google Doc. So I'm going to skip over to the Google Doc to ask a question that came to us that way. And this question is, can the schools make it mandatory to wash hands after PE and recess before snacks and lunch? Noting that there are sinks in our classrooms, reminding kids to change their mask every 3 hours, air the rooms while when social distancing is impossible. These are essential safety rules. can we talk a little bit about, and in the, you know, in full transparency, this person notes that they're not being followed now, but can we kind of clarify that these, you know, the rules that we that are in place and how we're doing our best to make sure they're being followed?
Yes. So we definitely work very hard to make sure that everyone is at least, first of all, you have to train them to so that they know and they're aware. And then our administrators do a fantastic job of monitoring what's happening on their campuses. So the administrators are checking to see, you know, what's going on. Now, again, we don't want to cross-contaminate classrooms. So we don't go into classrooms necessarily because, again, we don't want to be bringing in something to a classroom that doesn't need to be brought in there. However, that means that the administrator is still walking by, still checking, will still go into a classroom when they need to. They're still doing observations. They're still doing virtual, and they can see what's going on in the classrooms because they have those interactive flat panels. They can still see what's happening in the classroom. That's one of the beauties of having some hybrid classrooms. And that's how we know. Now, if there's ever a case, we do follow up. And as soon as we are notified of some concern, then we follow up. And that is one of the tasks that is part of my role as the district COVID coordinator, is to help follow up and make sure that these strategies are being implemented. And, you know, 99% of the time they were being implemented. It might not be what that person thought it was that was happening. But once we follow up, we usually find out that actually they were following protocols. They were doing what they needed to. So
maybe a good sort of public service announcement, if people feel like in their child's classroom, if they feel like something's not being followed, please let us know.
Absolutely.
And, right. And let your campus Absolutely. COVID coordinator know. The campus COVID coordinator works really hard to make sure these rules are in place in their campus. So if something's not going well, then they would want to know that that's not going well. But like Sharon said, a lot of the concerns that are brought forward to us, we spend a lot of time investigating these from different angles. And it's oftentimes a case where someone just doesn't have the full story. And it's difficult sometimes to make sure people understand people at some point just have to trust that we've looked into it because of the confidentiality of the cases. We can't go too much into some of the details, but if something's not working well on our campuses and we find out, then we definitely want that to make that better. This is a group effort. This is something we have poured our souls into the last several months. So we would definitely want to be notified.
Right. And for you parents out there, if you're not sure who your campus COVID coordinator, you can always feel free to email your principal. I know Ms. Donald, Mr. Yonker would say that they're the probably your best contact to ask questions about your child or your situation. Another one from our questions who came in advance, and I think this is a pretty straightforward one. Brandy, I'm going to guess you might want to jump in on this one. Will my children be forced to get the COVID vaccine in order to attend school next year?
Yeah, and that's something that we talked about in the presentation earlier. That's the vaccine requirements are developed by the DSHS, the Department of State Health Services for the state of Texas. That's not something we have control over. I would imagine since the vaccine, the pediatric vaccine hasn't even gone through the trials yet, that's not something that would be on the vaccine schedule for next year. But I can imagine that there would be some process for parents to go through if they didn't wish their child to have the vaccine now or after it rolls out. So there's definitely more information to come as far as that goes. It's not something that I've heard.
I think we might be having some technical difficulties.
Am I back on now? So sorry about that, everyone. Let me get back to my questions. Maritza, are you able to pull up the Q&A? Because I don't have anything in my Q&A now since it kicked me off.
Yes, I'll go ahead and send it to you right now.
Can you go ahead and ask a question so they can start?
So one of the questions we have is, will remote learning be offered in the fall? Are there any proposed changes to the approach if it's offered?
So I'm wondering if Dr. Presley, if you want to take that one.
Yeah, I'll take that one. So right now, we really don't know. We don't know if the state's going to allow us to offer virtual learning in the fall with ADA attendance. So it's kind of it's a huge question right now, because as we build our models for staffing, for projection for the fall for our budget, we really don't know. TEA would be the first step in saying we're going to allow districts to do this, but we do have models built in that will be discussed Thursday night in the board meeting of if we have virtual and if we don't have virtual, because we have students who have done very well on virtual and we have students who have struggled on virtual. So we're kind of looking at that as a discussion Thursday night in our regular board meeting. But the end game is we don't know if TEA will allow school districts to have virtual or not. So I hope that answers the question.
Thank you, Dr. Presley. Another question that was sent ahead of time, and Dr. Presley, this might be one for you as well, but Sharon, this might be something you can weigh in on. How can we maintain social distancing during STAR testing this spring if we are expected to have class on those days along with testing?
Yeah, we're allowed to have some asynchronous time for testing. The state does give us some advantages to allow students asynchronous time so that we can have more space in the building. So we had a meeting earlier or this morning with our high school principals to talk about the overlap of end-of-course testing and AP testing and IB testing. The College Board is being a little, I don't say negligent, but they're not giving us a lot of information right now about how testing will take place for our AP testing. But we know we may have a great number of kids testing on the campus at the same time, whether it's EOC or AP. And so we're navigating that with our principals. And we want to make sure that we have, if on-site testing is required, that we have enough staff and enough social distancing to make that happen. So I think maybe that answers that.
And I also saw the same was a question about the PSAT. And I would agree, that's the same as what Dr. Presley just said as well, is to ensure that we have a space for social distance and that we do require everyone to wear their masks and still follow all of our protocols.
Tanya, we have a question again that was sent in advance about at-risk teachers being required to work from schools. Can you explain a little bit about the leave and alternative work arrangements that have been offered, but then also sometimes the challenges in being able to accommodate everyone?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. We have in the leave portal, we've developed a leave portal for employees to apply and request for leave. We have two types of leave. We have AWA, which runs through someone in your home is high risk. And then we have ADA, where it's an employee's own health condition, which is a high risk. Employees are free to apply for those leaves, and we've reviewed numerous requests. However, there are limitations. So if campus needs and student needs on campus, we may not be able to meet all the requests and accommodations. So some of those requests were granted in the beginning, and then because of student need on campus, those reviews are taking place currently. We've had a couple of rounds where teachers have had to come back on campus, but we still have our safety protocol in place. And so when someone's asked to return to campus, we follow our COVID guidelines to ensure safety and operate under the best safe models that we can.
Thank you. I'm sorry, some of them, I start to read them and realize we've answered that because some are similar. Give me 1 second. when, Brandy, this is probably for you, when COVID-19 vaccines become available for kids, is that something they can get through school nurses, or would families be expected to get the kids vaccinated outside of school?
Yeah, that's something that we'll just have to wait and see how the state rolls that out. Most vaccines are not administered on school property because, you know, we would have to be able to assure that we would be able to provide all the safety that was necessary if a kid had a reaction to a vaccine on the campus level. So that would be something that we would have to explore more at the time. You know, as we're trying to, as a nation, as we're trying to vaccinate, you know, millions and millions of people, I can imagine that the school nurses will be a vital role, will play a vital role. We're just waiting to see how that will roll out, especially, you know, what time of year that would come out, depending on when the pediatric doses become available. So we're all just waiting to see how we can make it more available for all of us.
Great. Here's a question about the dashboard. If only on-campus learners are reflected on the dashboard, are virtual learners who are coming on campus for specific classes or extracurriculars, are they reported on the dashboard, or do, you know, when we send out communications, does that apply to those children as well?
Yes, and I should have made that more clear. When I say on-campus learners or on-campus employees, I'm referring to any time anybody comes up to campus. That would even include a parent who is a visitor. Maybe they had to come up for some specific reason, and they're what we would consider an essential visitor, because again, remember, that's all that we're allowing in our buildings. But if they are, then they would be considered an on-campus person. And yes, we would notify the entire community. Even if they don't come to school because they're not taking classes in school, but they're just practicing, or they're doing athletics or band or anything like that, then yes, we would still consider them an on-campus learner, and therefore they would be reported on the dashboard.
Okay. This question is an interesting one that I think Brandy did allude to and talk about a little bit, but maybe just being a little more specific or diving a little more deeply, because we are located in two counties. You know, they talk about the fact that we get data from both Williamson County and Travis County. Is their data measured the same way? How do we consolidate both and arrive at decisions? Do we weigh one county more than another? I think this is a question we get a lot, so I think it's worth spending some time on.
Yeah, it is. It's very confusing having our boundaries be in two different counties. So we have 10 of our campuses are in Travis County, located in Travis County. And the rest of our 44 campuses and the rest of our district buildings, if I'm not mistaken, are all in Williamson County. So very interesting to have a little taste of both sides of the fence there. The dashboard there, those two counties do have different dashboards, but basically they report the same information, not with the same consistency. Austin Public Health only updates their positivity rate once every 2 weeks. It's a little bit more consistent on the Williamson County dashboard. It's basically the same information though. We confer with both counties, we report to both counties, we take recommendations from both counties, but again, those are just recommendations for us, and the school district has to decide what works best for us as a school district. It was different in the summer. It was a little bit different in the summer when we had one county narrowing down the strength and conditioning for the schools in their county, and then we decided as a district to not have it in any of the schools for equity purposes. Anyway, it's something that we weigh and balance a lot, but it is, you know, both counties definitely have our best interest at heart. They both have similar recommendations. They're not exactly the same. It would be so much easier for us if they were the same, but we just weigh both and decide what works best. But again, we're just thankful for the partnerships of both of them because we are in daily contact with both counties.
Okay. Sharon, you might have answered this one, and I apologize, seeing as I was frozen just for a minute, but there's an interesting question about for kids that are virtual and if they're heading in for the PSAT, but I'm sure there's other reasons they might need to come to campus. Are there any extra precautions that they need to take?
So one of the things that we do is we make sure, and I believe that our campuses are putting signage up on how to enter the building, where to go specifically, so that we're not intermingling and we're not passing by other kids. So we're doing our very best to make sure that they are entering and exiting appropriately. as well as, again, like I said, making sure that we're all wearing our masks. We have the supervision in the place, in the rooms, and that we have enough space between students. So that is one of the things that we are working on now, is finding the spaces to make sure that we can spread out and that we can have our kids socially distance, including desks and making sure that the desks are separated, because we have always utilized tables, and this applies especially in younger grades. So desks were a little hard to come by, but we have managed to do that, and we are continuing to spread out as we can.
And we have a question that I can answer. Will this be available in another language for others to be able to listen in? And we are recording this, and then we will be closed captioning it in Spanish, so it will be available in Spanish. And then our campuses that have high percentage of English language learners, we have interpreters there, and our campuses do an amazing job of outreach to make sure that all our families have the information that they need. Interesting question. Many people in our community do not believe in COVID-19 or wearing masks. Will there be mandatory quarantining if someone comes in with a fever or other COVID symptoms but refuse to get themselves or their children tested?
Absolutely.
Yes, this is something Brandy, that we run into. This is something that we run into every now and then. You know, we can't control what other people believe, but we can help to keep everybody consistent with the guidance that we offer at the school. So if a student is sent home with a fever or such, they still have to stay home. The guidance would be the same. So if they have come up with a COVID symptom, they have to stay home for 10 days, just like if they were diagnosed with COVID. So this is to combat that exact thing that you're saying. So people can't change the timeline based on whether they choose to have a test or not. If you choose to get tested and you test positive, you would stay home for 10 days and have to satisfy certain criteria to be able to come back to the campus. Same thing if you were called from your student's school because you had one of the symptoms, fever, sore throat, cough, those kind of things, your student would go home and have to stay home for 10 days before they could come back. The only way that they can come back earlier is if they were to have a doctor's note that would release them to come back to school, or if they had a negative COVID test. So those are the stop gaps that the CDC and the state agencies have put in place to help us keep the kids safe upon their return, to keep the people that are at the school safe from whoever's coming back after their illness.
Thank you. And Dr. Presley and Mr. Yonker or Ms. Donald might want to weigh on this as well. We've gotten several questions phrased in different ways, but essentially wondering why we wouldn't be 100% virtual at this point, since we are in stage 5 restrictions, and that there is a requirement, of course, for the state, but the Texas Education Agency, that we continue to provide in-person education. But Dr. Presley, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, so I think you just said it. So we're required by law to provide in-person learning for students to desire that, families that. So that's kind of where we are right now. So we're between a rock and a hard place. I know the virus is spiking, especially in Central Texas and Austin area. We get that, but TA does not give us a pass to say we're going to shut all of our schools down for a period of time. Specific schools, we can, if we have an outbreak, I guess an occurrence of the virus that affects a certain part of a school or an entire school in any one time, but we're not allowed to shut our district down per TA. And TA is our funding mechanism, the money that we get, you know, to pay our teachers' salaries. That's where we are. So regardless of our individual philosophies, we're not allowed to shut everything down at one time. So,
and there was a question too about asking for a waiver from TEA. Do you want to explain a little about how that would work? And that's really in very extreme circumstances. It's not something they're granting out of hand.
We have shut a school down already this year, to much controversy. So we do have the ability to do that. As I said, a part of a school the contagious nature of the virus has become paramount, or you know, an entire campus, which we've done before. So we monitor that on a daily basis and rely on our health authorities to tell us this school needs to close because there's so many positive cases, so many people that are quarantined or whatever, that we do that. But we continue to keep our schools open. You know, one of our, in the very beginning of this, you know, is when we open our schools, we wanted to target to be as safe as possible. So open our schools and keep our schools open. And we've done that for the most part. But we're reluctant to shut a school down unless there's a, the virus is so prevalent that we have to shut an entire school down.
Okay. Ruben, it's your turn. I'm sorry, you've been quiet too long. So we have a question for you now. How are you handling the ventilation systems in schools? If kids are in the classroom wearing masks, then take their mask off for lunch, they're breathing the same air. Can you talk just a little bit about what operations and maintenance have done to make sure that we have updated those things?
I know a little bit about that. They switched over to a MERV 13 filter that will filter out more of the air. And then they also they're using another system that I'm not too sure about that, but I know that they change out all the filter systems in the district to help that out.
I just want to say Ruben's our director of custodial services. He can talk at length about sanitizing and cleaning, and we do have folks in the department that are specific to the ventilation systems. But Sharon, you please jump in.
Sure, I can talk a little bit about that. We actually retrofitted all of our filters that were not up to the grade that they needed to be. So we have between MERV 8 to MERV 13, which is a type of filter. And think of like HEPA filter. We also have HEPA filters that really filter out bacteria, viruses. It's really made to catch those. But in addition to that, we have a system that pushes in fresh air from outside. And this happens every single day. Before school even starts, before anyone comes on, there's a schedule for the outside coolants to bring in fresh air and to push fresh air throughout the building. So think of it as in shoving fresh air in and getting rid of the old air. But that's really our basic ventilation systems. And certainly I know our director of maintenance, David Hodebeck, would be able to answer a whole lot more than I'm able to, but we do have a lot that we have done in order to try our very best to make sure that we are keeping the virus away from anybody on our campuses.
This next question might be best for Tanya Davis or Dr. Presley, and it's about what seems to be a substitute teacher shortage, and I know this is not just an issue around Rock ISD, it's an issue across Texas, it's an issue across the country because of the circumstances that we're in. So Tanya, do you want to talk a little bit about where we are with that, what we've done to try to bolster those?
Sure. We partner with the HR department. HR has coordinators that handle the substitute pool, and our substitute pool is Central Texas. We're competing with Austin, Leander, Pflugerville, Georgetown, Round Rock. So we compete with all of our local schools to get substitutes. And so when we have a high need for it, it does present some issues. We are training our substitutes. There have been HR has done a wonderful job of training a core group of substitutes to help virtually. Just like we had to go through training with our employees, we had to go through training with our substitutes for them to learn our virtual platforms. So they're helping out where they can. Many subs are currently working on campuses where needed, but due to shortages because of their own health concerns and issues as well, they're high risk. We may not have as many subs as we would normally have in this process. A lot of retired teachers are substitutes and they're not able to for health concerns or health risk as well. But the HR department is doing a wonderful job coordinating, trying to fill our substitutes as fast as we can when those needs arise. Dr. Presley, you want to add anything?
Yeah, I mean, we're in the same dilemma that every district is in the state of Texas and probably across the nation. As Tanya said, a lot of our substitutes are retired teachers. They're folks who are more at risk than others. And so there's a sub shortage right now. If you look on paper, we're with the projection of our this year, we're over 3,000 students under enrolled in the district. So we have additional teachers, but we're trying to be cautious not to move teachers around from elementary to elementary. So the students who have an affection for their teacher in second grade, they don't move their teacher to move to another. This is real. So we're not in any different place than anyone else. We're just trying to navigate that and make sure our students are taken care of every day. I also want to point out the challenges our principals, because on a day-to-day basis, they don't know who's going to be quarantined, who's, you know, how many teachers they'll have in a certain grade level or a certain subject area that may be called to be quarantined. And so they're moving on a daily basis. It's just kind of a very fluid environment to make sure classes are covered, are taken care of, really changing time. So.
And Dr. Presley, you were cutting out just a little bit there, so I apologize if you did address this, but I just did want to point out that our board has recently increased our substitute pay. And so we are working on it from that angle. But as Tanya said, a lot of the folks who are in our substitute pool are people who are potentially high risk. So that seems to be more of the driving factor in that decision.
Our board. Yeah, go ahead.
No, you go ahead. Okay, so we'll go to the next.
Our board increased our sub pay. So.
Okay. Sorry, Dr. Presley, we're having a little bit of audio difficulty with you there.
Jenny, can I chime in?
Yes, please.
I thought I'd at least say good evening. I think the role of the principalship, I think, that has changed drastically. And I think their daily responsibilities have really changed from what they were typically to on a daily basis, recalibrating the needs of their on-campus and virtual students. And substitute teachers are one part of that solution, and so are the other remaining staff members, covering down and changing their daily routines to make all of this puzzle that the pieces change shapes every day. So I think that there's a lot of energy and effort that goes into it. But I understand the frustration where on a given day we have a substitute rather than the teacher, or all of a sudden I'm at school but my teacher is quarantined at home teaching back to the school. And although those things are not ideal, it's trying to find the best possible scenario considering the challenges that have been put in front of those schools. And I think that seeing how it's working behind the scenes, it's a very complex, complicated process that none of them would choose. However, they're doing the very best they can with the challenges that are put in front of them. But yes, the numbers change on a daily basis, and they can go home this afternoon and tomorrow morning their reality can be very different based on the data, and a phone call can basically, and Sharon would probably attest that a single phone call back to the school can change the entire plan for the next day. So it's substitutes are part of it, and then the rest of the staff are being asked to do things that are larger than what we'd normally do. So I just want to point out it is a team effort to make all of this happen the best that we can.
Thank you so much. That campus perspective is so valuable. And I know most folks, you have a relationship with your campus, maybe one or two campuses depending on the age of your students, but we have 55 campuses with varying challenges. Some have 60% of their student enrollments coming every day. Some have 10% of their students coming every day and 90% virtual. So there certainly is no one size fits all approach. And that means our principals are our generals in the field making decisions every day and doing an absolutely amazing job. So we appreciate that. a question about looking into our crystal ball a little bit. If for in-person schools next school year, do we anticipate students still needing to wear masks, social distance? Sharon, Brandy, has there been discussion on that?
Yes, our recent calls with Austin Public Health are talking about how many percentage, you know, it'll be a very high percentage of the community that would need to be vaccinated before the herd immunity would be achieved that would be necessary to decrease some of our mitigation strategies. So they were anticipating that we would need to be wearing masks going into the fall semester and then being able to relax a little bit as we go forward, depending on when the pediatric vaccine would roll out. You know, we would hope by the beginning of the fall semester that any of the adults in our schools and any of our individuals over 16 that were interested in the vaccine would have had access at that time. But you think about the majority of the people that would be in that school building would be under 16 at most of our campuses. And so the need for the mask, according to the health departments, will probably still be there into the fall. And then we'll be able to adjust that as we see how it goes forward in the fall.
And just like Brandy said, I echo exactly what she said. But remember that we really do abide by and listen to the CDC, our local health authorities, the Texas Education Agency, UIL. We have a whole bunch of people that we listen to. But knowing that we will utilize our health authorities in determining what kinds of mitigation strategies we use. So if the CDC is still recommending masks, we will still be recommending masks as well.
And there's a question that kind of fits nicely in with how you set that up, Sharon. And it's, does Williamson County and Cities Health agree that you're doing all you can to keep students safe? Is this based on their recommendations? So I think talking about the relationship that both you and Brandy have with our health authorities would be helpful.
Brandy, you want to talk about?
Sure. The health departments and from Austin Public Health and Williamson County, both of our health authorities recommend that we have virtual learning at this point in the virus transmission stages that we're in, that with the advanced transmission. But they also both recognize that school districts in this area, it's not like Round Rock ISD is alone in this, all the school districts in this area have to follow TEA. So they work very well with us and are very complimentary on our calls as far as how amazing the efforts are that the school districts put into place and how well things are going in the schools. They work very well with us within the boundaries of what they know we have to follow. So they're going to stay true to their science that they really do think that it would be best if we were at home. It's virtual for until we are out of these advanced stages, but they are very aware of the realities that we can't just go virtual just because. So it's something that we have to balance and are very much hoping TEA can take another look at these at this stuff as we move forward and see if they need to reevaluate.
So we have a lot of questions that, you know, maybe sort of bleed over a little into our next week when we talk about teaching and learning. Because they have to do with virtual learning, but I do think they're appropriate to ask tonight because it's also, you know, sort of under the umbrella of health and safety. And as I'm setting this up, Dr. Presley, this might be one for you. If you might want to try leaving your camera off since you're having we're having a little audio difficulty because that that might help things. But the question really is about how long will we continue virtual? Do we plan to continue this year, which of course we have said yes, we will continue the option for the school year. But then also the question of what about next year? Do we plan to continue offering virtual next year? And if so, what does that look like? Does that mean on-campus instruction looks similar to this year? Because we are, you know, using the same platform for both learners. So do you want to address that a bit and where we are?
Yeah, I think that's a really complex question because we don't even know at this point in time if TEA will allow us to have virtual for next year. We are doing planning in the district to make that an option if that's available. But we're waiting to hear from our trustees as well. I think the spike in the virus right now has made things very complicated. We all thought we might be getting to the end of this by now, but really not. And so, so how to reestablish in-person learning for those who choose that in the fall versus virtual, if that's an opportunity in the fall, is kind of a million-dollar question. So we're kind of preparing ourselves so that virtual is an option. We do that. We know that a lot of our kids have been successful virtually. A lot of our kids have not been successful virtually. And the virtual option also propagates a different environment on our campuses, right? So we've got to make sure that we're providing the best opportunity for all of our students as we move forward. But I think that's a question that's one, established by the state, whether we even have virtual or not as an option, and then what those options look like as we move forward.
And one person actually, just to kind of piggyback on that, asks if we've considered or discussed at all forming, you know, a 100% virtual school that someone could enroll in, you know, that would be like a smaller population dedicated just to that. And, you know, from a just sort of exploring and brainstorming idea, Dr. Presley, do you want to talk about that at all and what that might, that would entail at, from a state perspective as well? It would entail a change in state law, correct?
Yeah, obviously, once again, it's based on what the state allows us to do. But if we were to have a virtual option, it would be advantageous to the district to centralize that at elementary, middle, and high to try to bring more normalcy to our campuses that are functioning for families who want in-person learning as much as possible. But that's and that's a difficult situation we're in, is trying to navigate this in January of 2021. Trying to figure out what August of 2021 will look like for the next school year. So we'll have more conversations with that, of course, as we move forward, but we really don't know at this point. So,
right. Sharon and Brandy, another one back to kind of safety protocols. In December, the American Academy of Pediatrics put out new guidelines recommending students participating in indoor sports wear face coverings during group training and competition, as well as on the sidelines. Are we following this new recommendation?
So, again, this is tricky because you're dealing with multiple people in multiple groups. UIL has their own set of rules, and our athletics department go by UIL. And so I'll tell you that we, on the sidelines, absolutely 100% masks should have to be worn. But we still have the UIL guidelines that state that sports players who are actually playing on the field do not have to wear masks. And, you know, we've got basketball coming up, we have wrestling, we have soccer, we have volleyball, of course we've had football, and baseball will be coming. Baseball is actually one of our better sports because you can socially distance quite a bit in baseball. The others are not so much. And that's where we have to look at when things do occur, whether we need to, you know, if we have a case where there are multiple cases on a team and then there's close contact and so on, then we follow our protocols, of course, with that, as well as looking at when we do need to shut down a team. And we've done that before on some of our campuses, and that's what we would continue to do.
I'm wondering if maybe Dr. Presley or maybe one of our area superintendents who have both been high school principals, for our maybe elementary parents, define UIL for us. I remember when I first moved to Texas and everybody kept talking about UIL and I couldn't even find what the acronym stood for. I think we take it for granted that everybody in Texas knows what UIL is. So can one of y'all explain that a bit and why their guidance is so important?
Yeah, University Interscholastic League is our governing body for extracurricular activities, not just for sports, but for academics, for theater, for band and choir, orchestra. So that's what UIL is. So I don't know any further explanation that's needed, but they put, for example, starting the year, any venue where we have an activity taking place, UIL's parameter is that we have 50% attendance. So if you have a gym, a football stadium, a soccer match, whatever it may be, they're saying not to exceed 50%. So since the beginning of the year, we've had counters at our, you know, start with volleyball in the fall, that no more than 50% could come into a gym. We've marked all of our facilities, our gyms, our stadiums, our baseball and softball fields for the spring to make sure that folks know for the distancing part where they can sit and where they can't sit. And we will not allow more than 50% of the capacity of that venue into the venue. So that's kind of what it is. But UIL is our governing body from the state as far as all extracurricular activities, whether it's athletics, fine arts, or whatever it may be.
Thank you, Dr. Presley. I think this probably is a question for Mr. Yonker or Ms. Donald. Is the district giving guidance to extracurricular groups that want to have in-person banquets for students? And I know this is probably more an issue at the secondary level.
I mean, right now we would say no in-person banquets just because of the safety guidelines. We have been strategically talking with high school, middle school, and elementary about what those events are coming up in the spring. You know, you've got senior awards, you've got, you know, prom, you've got the graduation walk. Well, there are some things that as time goes on, we may not be able to do because it cannot be done safely. Another situation is if you're going to be limited with the number of people that can be at a particular event, is that event really what it's designed to be? You know, even if a prom and you say, well, you can only have 25%, well, 25% gets to go to the prom. And so the principals, all levels of principals are already working on what are those alternate plans that we can put in place to celebrate kids, try to keep the traditions that we have going, and then, but make it safe. I mean, safety's got to come first. So I know that principals right now are planning. There was a discussion in elementary the other day about Valentine's cards. And I know some of us go, what? But that's very important. That is something that we've done for many, many years. So can we do that safely? And if we can't, how do we do something to celebrate that? So I think there's a lot of planning going on. And to me, I would reach out to, you know, your campus principal if you want to help and support those positions in any way or those events.
And I'll note that we do have some information going out this week for our seniors and their parents. And we will work very hard, as we did at the end of your last year, to make sure we're honoring those seniors and doing everything possible. But this is challenging for them particularly. This is a question, again, back to our stars of the evening, Brandy and Sharon. What is the protocol if a parent tests positive?
If a parent tests positive, then anyone that lives in the household would be a close contact if they're not able to keep distance in the household. So if it's an older student who really can maintain their distance and has a separate bathroom and can really keep away from the family, that quarantine could be 14 days. If it's a parent in the household that has it am I saying the right thing, Sharon? I'm getting off track.
You are. Yes.
So if a parent has it, then we would definitely need to the students would be close contacts, and then they would be monitored for the students might have any symptoms, and that would then make them be a probable case anyway. If they're a close contact to the parent, then that would be 14 or 24 days, depending on their ability to stay away from their parent. If they develop symptoms because they are a close contact, then they could be considered a probable case, and that would make them be in isolation for 10 days. So the main thing is if someone is identified, you want to make sure to stay in contact with the school nurse or the campus COVID contact to make sure that the timelines are updated based on symptomology that's coming up at the house or situations changing, those kind of things. Because like I was saying earlier, the variables change in these situations so often, and what appears to be close, you know, clear cut is often not and needs another eye. So don't be afraid to reach out to your campus if you feel like you have some questions.
And it's really important too to let the community know. Please, please, please notify your campus nurse, notify your campus COVID contact. If you are COVID positive and you're a parent, it's really critical that we get this information because we do need to identify the close contacts and quarantine and those kinds of things. No shame, nothing like that. We just need to know, because that information is really important to what happens in next steps on the campus. And so if we're all going to remain safe and we're all going to do our best to keep each other safe, then we have that responsibility to just let each other know when this is happening, because there's so many people involved on the campus level.
I think I can actually answer this next question, but I'll ask Dr. Presley to be ready to back me up in case I don't answer it fully. But I do sense a little frustration with our state agency in it. The question reads, what is it going to take for TEA to decide to allow schools to close and still receive funding? How did AISD close the week after break? Maynard has closed over positive teachers. And just to answer the second part of that question, Austin ISD did remain 100% virtual coming back from winter break, but the way that they're going to be doing that is they have to extend their school year. So there's a certain number of minutes that students have to attend school in order to get school funding. So that means a change to their calendar. And our community has been, and there's an, also another point that the school year has to be finished by a date certain. So, you know, you have to think about with your community, do they want to trade that for extending the school year, and then where will we be at that point in time? And then you also have sort of the backstop of there's a date certain when the school year has to be completed. So in that case, they are altering their school year. And with Manor ISD, as you note, TEA does allow you to close if you have a staffing shortage due to COVID. Manor is a much smaller district than we are, so we have not been in a situation where we don't have enough staff so that the entire district has to shut down. But if we have a large outbreak in a school or a particular campus, there are not enough teachers there, we do have the option then to shut that campus down, and we have closed campuses based on that. So I hope that answers that question. And I'll add too that since the beginning of this, both our board president and superintendent have been active in writing to the governor, writing to the Commissioner of Education, and pleading the case of school districts. And we'll continue to do that, particularly as the Texas legislature is now in session. Dr. Presley, is there anything else to add to that one?
No, I think you covered it all. We haven't amended our calendar of the end date, you know, the last day of school. So we're working to try to keep the constructs of our calendar as it was established and approved by our board and put forth by our community to this point. But districts that are shutting down like that are having to extend the school year, as Jenny said. So I don't think I have much to add to that.
Okay. There's a couple of questions. One, actually, they state that it's a comment, but they would like to have it noted, and so noted, I understand, about a concern about space in elementary classrooms. One parent says, you know, there's just not enough space to social distance, and with more kids coming back to campus, that's going to continue to be the case, and would like that noted. And then another parent asks, how are students able to social distance when we have 20 plus students in a classroom? You know, everywhere else we go, they say don't gather in groups of 10, but in schools, we have more than that. So you guys want to talk a little bit about mitigation strategies and the fact that, yes, there are some things that come out of our control.
Right. So we have this conundrum because we want a social distance, but we only have a finite amount of space on our campuses. And so when you take a look at that, of course, we do our very best to spread out as much as possible. But there are cases where we have 20 kids in a classroom or more, and they can't social distance. And in those cases, I want to go back to what, you know, has been talked about previously in some school board meetings that we had, which is something called the Swiss cheese model. And it is referring to all the layers that are put in place. And if you think of Swiss cheese as having those holes to allow the virus through, and each layer stops the virus. And so you can look it up, the Swiss cheese model for COVID-19, but looking at that layered approach, if we don't have social distancing, that's one layer, yes. But we have other layers, such as cleaning and making sure we have cleaning protocols, washing our hands, making sure that we are definitely keeping our hands and not touching our faces. And then also our masks. And that's a really big one, is keeping our masks on. So while you may not be able to do this particular layer because We are governed by the Texas Education Agency. And as I said, we have a finite amount of space on our campuses. And so we also have a finite number of teachers. So we don't have the luxury of having, you know, so many different teachers, you know, and having a fewer number of kids. We do our best, but again, in campuses where they have more student population returning, they can't maintain the small numbers of classes. And in that case, we follow our other protocols. Again, we're not seeing the transmission from students to teachers. We're seeing more of transmission when staff are doing things outside of school or things such as that. So, and same with students for that matter, especially high school students who are doing things when they're not in school. So just to remind everybody that while we may not be able to maintain that social distance piece, there are other protocols that we did put in place, and that's the reason we did it.
We have a couple of similar questions. One wanting to know how their, you know, voices can be heard at TEA, and one which I partly answered, asking what's being done to advocate if we disagree with decisions. And as I said, as a district, we have been, you know, in touch and advocating and sharing our story and sharing challenges of schools. But and so have districts across the state, as well as organizations. For example, we belong to the Texas School Alliance, which is a group of about 40 of the largest school districts in the state. And there is that direct line. But for parents, if they disagree with decisions and would like to make their voices heard, I would encourage you to contact our local state representatives. You know, you can email TEA, but honestly, the best way to really try to influence change is to talk with your elected officials. If you go on our district website, in our A through Z directory, you can look up our legislative priorities page, and we actually have contact information for our local elected representatives. And as I said, the Texas legislature is in session. They're making important decisions related to public education right now. So that would be my suggestion. Another question that we've talked about, but it's fairly put to us fairly directly, and again, I think this might be something that either Dr. Presley or Mr. Yonker or Ms. Donald might want to answer. There's no wonderfully right answer to it, but why does the district continue with the risk of extracurricular athletics during stage 5 transmission? This seems unnecessary and not required by TEA for funding. And, you know, I would just kick it off by saying there's a lot of discussion around this. These decisions are not made in a cavalier manner, but there are a lot of facets to weigh, you know, including the fact that these are voluntary, you know, no one is forced to participate in extracurricular activities. And we also think about, frankly, what our students have been through as a parent myself, you know, since March, and the lack of interaction, the lack of opportunity to do things outside. And, you know, Dr. Presley, do you want to talk a little bit about making those decisions and also being in line with what our neighboring districts are doing?
Yeah, our UIL district includes schools in Leander ISD as well as Hutto ISD, which has one high school. And, you know, our decisions have been congruent. We as we measure what we're trying to do in the districts that we compete with, especially in our UIL district with Leander and Hutto, we're trying to stay the same. And we haven't mitigated that. And I know some districts at certain periods in time have gone to varsity only. You know, we're only competing at varsity. We're doing away with middle school sports temporarily or sub varsity sports, JV in ninth grade. And so we've tried to maintain that. And I think an important talking point on this is also the social emotional piece that we talk about all the time, that we're really tuned into, that kids who, you know, their passion for going to school is that they want to play basketball, or they want to play softball, or they want to play baseball. You know, that's their deal. And to take that away, last spring when the pandemic hit in March, you know, we had kind of a lost year for a lot of kids in spring sports with track and field, baseball, softball, just basically your season's canceled. if you're a senior, I'm sorry, this is the end of it. And so it's trying to maintain that piece that a lot of kids connect to school in. I would also tell you there are a lot of kids, as a longtime high school principal, and John and Becky can weigh in on this, but as a longtime high school principal, a lot of kids, pass their classes so they stay eligible. So we're trying to look at our passing rates and keep kids eligible to participate. And just to do away with that and say we're not going to compete anymore is a pretty big decision. So right now we're trying to be as safe as possible with attendance at those events. And as we trend into spring sports, we'll still be cautious, but as Sharon, I think, said earlier, these are outside sports with baseball and softball and soccer, and soccer's kind of a winter into spring sport. Swimming and diving, I mean, I can go on and on, wrestling. We're hoping that we can continue these opportunities for students, because they have been lost opportunities last year, and we're trying our best to make sure those aren't lost opportunities for our students this year. So that's my best attempt to answer that. But I can tell you we're in our UIL district, which once again includes our five Round Rock High Schools, some schools in Leander and Hutto ISD. Everybody right now is moving forward with playing sports at all levels, middle school, sub-varsity, and varsity, and trying to make the best of it. And we'll see, moving forward, we'll see how successful we can be and being as safe as possible. So,
you know, Jenny, I also know that from when we began in the fall with the safety protocols and what we were doing during football and volleyball, I think coaches and players and parents of the players, we realized that if we follow safety protocols and we're reporting what we need to report, then we can continue on with that sport safely. And I think through the fall, we were able to look at that and make sure that importance and that everybody understood that piece of urgency. So if we want to play, if we want to use our skills, then we're going to have to follow those protocols, and we're going to have to report it when we're sick, you know, that we need to do that. So I think that, you know, as basketball is going through season, that they are learning about the indoor, soccer's learning from everybody, such as football. And then you've got social distance in track, you've got social distance in tennis and things like that. So I think our urgency about safety is there for all sports. And I think we're learning from each other.
Thank you. And this next question, it's kind of indicative based on that question to how split people in the community are, which makes it difficult for a school district then to make, there are no decisions that will satisfy everyone, right? So we have a parent saying, wondering why other ISDs around Round Rock ISD are back to full in-person teaching at the middle and high school level while we're still just having our kids sitting in front of their screens, essentially doing virtual. And I would just like to first say, a lot of times when people, we'll mention, well, what about this district? It's sort of my job, to go and research that. And almost every time that a claim has been made, back in the fall, we were told Houston ISD went back fully in person long before Round Rock ISD. When they said that, Houston ISD was still 100% virtual. Often I think people are talking to someone they know, and maybe that student's experience at that school has been good, or in that classroom, but it doesn't necessarily mean that that's what's happening across the school. And this might be a good one for Becky or John to weigh in on, because a lot of it has to do with how many students have come back, and that's up to the parents. So at a school where you have only 10% of kids in person, it's going to be difficult to have a very traditional approach to education. But you might have a school in that same district where 60% of students come back, and it looks fairly similar to school pre-COVID. Do you want to expand on that at all, Becky or John, or talk about what might be different in this district where it looks like that now?
Sure, I can attempt to do so. I think if our guiding practices are what we've established for safety will dictate a great deal dependent upon the total number of students. And every one of our schools is different. Every school that we collaborate with around the state is different based on a lot of factors. And those factors are the size of the school you had to begin with, the number of staff members you had to begin with, the number, the percentage of that this is, this whole issue has been created as being an option through TEA and the other agencies, is that it's been created as a choice. And when that choice is made, there's different communities that make different choices based on the beliefs. And that in itself drives a great deal of what school may look like on a given day. There are none of us that we all want it to go back to normal. We all want face-to-face instruction with your teacher in the classroom, and we want it as quickly as we can. That being said, we also know that we're in the midst of a pandemic that, unfortunately, back in March, we wanted to believe by January 19th of 2021, we would be much further along with a solution to these issues. So yes, it's going on longer than any of us had wanted it to, but you know, our default always will be, we want normalcy. We want all of those things to happen. And if a student's experience isn't ideal, we wish that it was, but it's going to be safe first, and then it's going to be instructional second. And I don't think for the most part, our community would want it in the different order, as much as we all want life back to go back to normal. So yes, I mean, there's too many factors to be able to compare two different schools that can, even in, that can be similar in size, can still be very, very different based on these other factors that are well beyond the control necessarily of the school. And I think that as you kind of went through that other information, we have people very passionate on all sides of this. And we recognize that daily, and we want to be respectful to all sides and then ultimately do what we believe as professionals in our field is the best decision. And Jenny, you're very, very correct. That unfortunately will not make everyone extremely happy necessarily, but in the end, we want to do the right thing. And every day is focused on that.
Thank you. That's important context. I appreciate that. Back to a science question. So Brandy, I think this might be for you. Have we discussed with the health department when herd immunity is expected to be achieved between positive cases and more people being vaccinated?
Yeah, we talked about that earlier as possibly being something that could happen in the fall. You know, it depends on which scientists you ask as far as how, what percentage of the population would need to be vaccinated before herd immunity could be achieved. I hear numbers of 85% thrown around. Right now we don't even have that many people in the area that would get the vaccine. They don't desire the vaccine even if it was available. In Round Rock ISD, we have done a survey amongst our staff, and we have 76% of our staff that do want to have the vaccine, which is a very enviable number when you talk to some of the health departments in some of our areas that are comparable. We have a lot of staff who are very interested, so we're hopeful that as the vaccine we get more access, that our staff will have access to that. It depends on what people in the community, how the number of people that are vaccinated in our community, not just our school staff. So anyway, like I said earlier, we'll have to wait and see how long it takes for the pediatric dose to become available and how many of our kids' parents choose to access that. But I think we're months and months away from that. So, you know, maybe even a year away from that. Again, this is all projections. These scientists are very interested this is a big science experiment. But I think a lot of people want hard answers and they're just not available at this time. So hindsight, we'll be able to really learn a lot from the situation. But right now, some of the best guesses I've heard are approximately a year from now before herd immunity would be able to be achieved in our area.
Okay. Well, I'm going to stick with you just for a little bit, Brandy, too, because we've had a couple of questions about district-wide COVID testing, so we could have a snapshot of where we are. Are there any plans? And I'll just preface it by saying, I know, Austin ISD has been doing some testing on site, but I want to be clear that it's not district-wide and it is voluntary. They're just providing those opportunities, and Tanya might come away on this as well. We also have contracted with Care Now so that our employees can go and receive COVID testing free of charge. But Brandy, you want to talk a little bit about
Yeah, we as a district are in contact with the Texas Division of Emergency Management to possibly have, we're exploring testing for the district. That's something that's in the exploratory phase right now, so more information to come. I can't imagine that we would ever have, like you said, it would have to be completely voluntary. There's permission slips involved. There's lots involved in the testing process. It's very complicated. It's not as simple as everybody just testing on one day and kind of having, again, a big science experiment that I wish we could do, but there's so many other factors at play. We have to have parent permission, and there's a lot of people who definitely do not want their students tested. So if we were to offer it here, it would be completely voluntary, but it's something that we're looking at offering on the district level. So more information to come as far as that goes.
Saw Dr. Presley's camera come on. I didn't know if you wanted to jump in or if I should go to the next. I'll head to the next question. Okay. Since children and families of color are at a higher risk of contracting COVID, dying from COVID, and having negative side effects from COVID, what are y'all doing as a district to meet the needs of communities of color? And I'll add that our chief equity officer is not on the call, but we do have a new position of chief equity officer in building that department currently. And this is something that he is in touch with Sharon and Brandy about. So Sharon, did you have anything to add on that?
Absolutely. So we want to protect all of our students, and we have some mitigation strategies that are in place for every one of our students. However, we also are in contact with our local health departments. And one of the things that we do when we're talking about case reviews with them is we look at communities, and we look at where the communities are located, and we look at everything in regards to that, socioeconomic status. Where there's transmission happening more in some communities than in other communities. And so we want to work really hard with them to protect all of our communities. And so we really do a lot with exploring with them when there are case reviews that happen. And so what I'm getting at is that if we have situations where there is one group that is overly identified because of COVID, then we work very hard with our health department to make sure that they're aware, and they work very hard with us to also tell us about trends happening in that community so that we can then better inform our COVID contacts, we can better inform the community, and we can help try to communicate more effectively with the community to make sure that they know the practices that need to happen. They know what needs to be put in place when you have winter break coming up. Because like I said, it seems that, there's a lot more that are safe when they're in school following our protocols than there are when they're out of school. And so we really look at trends, and it does include race. It does include other identifying areas, like I said, socioeconomic becomes one of them. But really, it's a pattern and a trend that we follow closely with our local health agencies to try to make sure that we can provide the resources to let people and communities know what they can and maybe should do differently, perhaps.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
This is an interesting question, and Dr. Presley, this is probably coming for you. It's really more of a teaching and learning, so this might come up again next week, but this parent is asking, is it possible to gain access to the entire grade curriculum and benchmarks ahead of time to avoid withdrawing from the district if virtual classes stop, so a virtual / homeschool hybrid? So to paraphrase a parent, that if we were no longer to offer virtual next year, a parent feels strongly, would there be some kind of way a parent could stay in the district and teach from home? That's complicated, but maybe we can start to address it.
Yeah, I think our town hall next week with teaching and learning would be more a more appropriate forum for that. But our parents can follow that. And once again, we're not into, I mean, obviously this year we're offering virtual and in-person learning throughout the year. I don't see that changing moving into the summer, but I think that's a more appropriate question for next week when we have our teaching and learning town hall.
Absolutely. Yeah. So please tune in for that. And Dr. Presley's audio cut out just a little bit, at least for me, but if you can hear that, our approved curriculum is actually available on our website. So you can track that at any time. It's on our teaching and learning webpage with a lot of other host of resources. But that's a good, I appreciate the question because it lets us know how important virtual is to some of our families. Let me scroll down. This is a question, and this might have been about a specific situation, so it might be difficult to answer, but that's certainly a scenario that could come up. Could you please discuss or explain why a school nurse would send a student home from school when they do not have a fever, maybe a vague symptom like a headache or nausea, fatigue, but they're still being sent home?
This is a really, really large conundrum for all the school nurses in the country because, the CDC has outlined a list of COVID symptoms, and a lot of them are very vague. So, in addition to fever, you know, runny nose, sore throat, fatigue, muscle achiness, that kind of stuff, which is really hard because we had all those symptoms before we had COVID, and they were all attributed to something else. And now we have to suspect that they could possibly be related to COVID whenever a student complains of those. It's a very difficult position for our school nurses to be put into, but it's something that we're tasked with doing, and so we do that on a daily basis around Rock ISD. When students are sent home with those symptoms, they are able to come, they're sent home to isolate for 10 days if they have any of the symptoms that are listed in all of our reimagining documents anyway. It's widely available, but mostly what I listed earlier. If you are interested, I mean, if the student goes home and rests and their parent feels like they should be back at school and their conditions improve, if they go to their physician and get a doctor's note to return to school, and if they have a negative COVID test, then they can come back to school. So it's not an automatic have to stay out for 10 days, but for safety purposes, this is what the scientists have asked us to do. We get a lot of pushback from families about it because, again, some of the symptoms are so vague, but it's what we're tasked to do to try to keep our communities and our schools safe. It's very interesting over the last couple of months that some of the symptoms that people think are just the slam dunks, you know, fever and these coarse coughs are definitely going to be the kids that test positive. And we're finding that that's often not the case. A lot of our cases are coming out as, you know, I didn't really feel sick. I just had allergies and I ignore them because I always have allergies. And then a couple of days later, they test positive and they thought they weren't sick. So they've exposed a lot of people. This is a story we hear over and over and over. And that's kind of why our community spread is probably like it is, because some of these symptoms are so vague. It's not something you can just look at somebody and say, that guy has COVID. It's very, very, it's very cruel.
And it can be different for different people. One person is not necessarily like another.
Exactly. It's very difficult also because some people that are testing positive are asymptomatic. So, you know, they are testing positive and they never had any symptoms. They were tested before a trip or before a medical procedure or whatever, and they turn out to be positive and they had no idea they didn't have symptoms. So again, it's cruel in that the period of infectiousness starts 2 days before the start of the first symptom. So comes up with fever or, you know, whatever these vague symptoms are, we have to count 2 days prior to that to decide who the close contacts were at that time to start our close contacts. And it's really hard because people say, well, she wasn't sick. We got together. She wasn't sick. But that's the cruel part of it, is that you are infectious before you start to show symptoms. So very, very difficult for our school nurses. I have to give a huge shout out to all the school nurses who really work so, so, so hard every day to keep the kiddos in their care safe.
This question, I think either of our area superintendents or Dr. Presley could probably address. Why don't we add more in-person teachers to enable and follow the CDC guidelines for the safety of our students? And I would imagine that's both a people power and space conundrum, correct?
Well, I think, you know, our principals are given a certain amount of allocations, and that's how they've built their schedule around those allocations and have assigned students to teachers. At this point in time, we go back to the same question. It's kind of like the sub. You know, when we talked about substitutes, we're really in the same situation as we are with hiring of teachers, because we've had some teachers leave for various reasons and struggle a little getting those positions filled because of the number of teachers that are currently maybe in that older category. They may be, you know, just right now, you know, maybe staying out a year in order for this COVID to kind of get over and rejoin the workforce. So the teacher workforce right now is not what we've seen it in the past, just because COVID is kind of, restricted us on the number of people who are looking for those positions. And the other thing is I think Dr. Presley referenced it, is that we are down a number of students in the district. And so do we need additional teachers or just being creative with what we have until we kind of know what's going to happen in the future with COVID?
Thank you. This next question, the question is phrased, will the kids be learning via teacher-led Blackboard learning or via laptop online inside the classroom? I'm not sure if they're referring to in the future or currently, but again, maybe John or Dr. Presley or Becky could talk a little bit about what our learning looks like now and how it might vary because of the campus and based on their situation. And why it's important, I think, that we be able to, as Sharon and Brandy have talked so much about, our close contacts and quarantining for 14 days and the ability to shift back and forth between virtual and in-person, you know, in some cases, like we had to shut down an entire campus, like why that's important.
I think the key from the beginning of this, probably since March, the discussion is about this is going to take a high degree of flexibility based on the unknown components of what we're challenged with. So, you know, is it possible that a student will be taught in a pod where they're virtual learning in our buildings? There are different scenarios where that it drives to that direction, depending on the number of students, the situation with the classroom teacher, the ability to have other teachers potentially present, or to have their teacher capable just under quarantine teaching back the other direction from home back to a group of students in the classroom. To say that won't occur would be very difficult to make that statement. I think what is important to understand is that the default that we want are for virtual learners to learn virtually and face-to-face kids to learn face-to-face. That is what we want. And when that doesn't happen, it's primarily because the numbers don't work out in these clean packages. And the number of staff that are qualified and certified and that are experts in their field are who we want in front of our kids, that we're trying to find that balance constantly. So, I think there's a lot of different tools that are being used. And I think that we talk all the time that when this is all over, we're going to be a whole lot better at lots of parts of this stuff, right? That we are better at it. And I've probably been on 500 Zoom and Google Meets calls since March, and probably 10 prior to March. And I think that our staff and our kids, that this is an experience that we'll build upon. But yeah, hopefully for a very short period of time, is it possible that that learning environment might not be the face-to-face component of it based on these other scenarios? The answer is to that is, as of right now, yeah, I don't think we would want to make some assurance that that won't happen.
There's a question that sort of piggybacks on there, John, since you're rolling with it now. What rules are in place to keep virtual class sizes reasonable? What are the ratios? Can you talk a little bit about the challenges there and kind of our guiding principles?
You know, again, we've talked about that from the beginning of what number, how many is too many? And if that is sort of that, you have that sort of tipping point of if those numbers are too small, then the face-to-face get larger. So I think that our primary focus for safety would be that we try to get better at the virtual instruction with larger number of students to allow as small a number as possible with the face-to-face. But again, those numbers, I, to, to be honest with you, we have guidelines that we try to follow, and that when those numbers get to a certain point, we look for other avenues and possibilities. And I think that number's probably shifted from the beginning of what we initially wanted to what the realities became. But I think that we recognize that, you know, 30 kindergartner kids are probably too many virtually. Now, in an AP government class, we probably can make those things happen at a different, based on, again, the age, the grade level, the for how long will this last, those kinds of things. So if we haven't learned anything in March, is there are not many steadfast rules to much of this, because we've had to be able to, you know, to adjust on the fly. We recognize and we understand the stress it's putting on our teachers to be doing both virtual instruction and simultaneously doing face-to-face instruction, to having large numbers. This year has been extremely challenging when teachers are teaching kids virtually that they had not met personally. Last spring that was different, but this year that's become one of our struggles. So is there a maximum number that we, probably not a guideline necessarily from the state. I mean, in the younger grades, there are the 22-to-1 ratio components of it, but for the most part, we keep them as small as we can, and knowing that, because we'll go back to that same question earlier, why are so many face-to-face kids in one room? Well, I mean, you have to choose between those two different scenarios and make the best decision, and I don't think any of our campuses have the identical setup because of all the different variables.
Mm-hmm. That kind of answers another question. Just let me get it out there so we know we are. Is it possible that on-campus numbers are low because of the conditions of the in-person experience? And I would say, based on the feedback, and we get a significant amount of feedback, there are lots of factors why parents might choose to keep their kids at home. And we have many, many families that there's, you know, it's a multi-generational household, or there's someone in the household that's a high risk, or the student is high risk. But in some cases, if it's convenient for the parent, for the child to learn from home, we have people that are very happy with the virtual instruction. Yes, things do look different on our campuses, and we acknowledge that. But there's also a tipping point in terms of, you know, more people on campus means something that's looks slightly more traditional. Is that fair? I mean, you don't have to add to it, but just want to make sure I'm characterizing that correctly.
I think so. I think that it's important to recognize too that there have been many, many hours spent with the discussion about how can we best create a student environment that is positive for that student and for all of our students. What does that look like? And I think it goes back to some of the things Dr. Presley was talking about earlier. Trying to find some normalcy with athletics, trying to have band and choir and some of the things that make school more fun for kids, and to actually experience school the best that we can, considering this incredibly difficult time that we're in. So yeah, I think that, you know, that same thing stands true. We've talked in great detail about what does it look like when a student walks into school, and what does their day look like, and how can we do some things to make that as positive experience as possible, considering the fact that we're, you know, trying to maintain all of these other expectations and primarily the safety protocols.
I want to make sure I leave some time for just sort of wrapping up and closing comments. So this is going to be the last question from the Q&A, another sort of scenario of someone who said they learned of a student who wasn't feeling well, went to the doctor, tested positive for strep, negative for COVID, but still had to self-quarantine for 14 days. Is that, Sharon or Brandy, can you speak to why that might have been the case?
That doesn't sound like a typical scenario, so I would have to, it sounds like one of those situations where we would need to find more information. We get reports about things like that sometimes, and when we go in to look at them, usually the person that reported them just didn't have the whole story. But if that is the whole story, that certainly isn't following the protocol. So anyway, it would be one of those scenarios where we just need to have a little bit more information.
Yeah. And the tricky part of that, if we do find out more information, because that's private information, we're not able to share it.
So. Yeah, it's a really hard one, but it's definitely something that we are willing to look into to make sure there wasn't something that wasn't followed correctly. So we can, if it was an opportunity to reteach somebody or make something right, that we always like to do that.
And just to reiterate what we said before, if you have questions on your campus, please speak to your campus administration. You have a COVID coordinator, or you can ask us questions, and we'll be sure to follow up. I want to give both Sharon, Dr. Presley, and then Trustee Harrison, if she'd like to say anything. Sharon, do you just anything, any sort of high points you want to wrap up or just a message?
I do. I'm not sure I was very clear in my answer from before. I was really talking when we were talking about communities or people of color or just different situations and the difference that it does in impacting people of color, and it does. The virus absolutely does. So what I was trying to talk through was like community communication and parent training or parent information that we're giving. But in addition to that, one of the things that we're so fortunate to have our Chief Equity Officer, Dwayne Street, because he has actually provided our area superintendents and who will then, of course, be sharing this information with principals as well about the impacts of what happens when you have communities of color and how it impacts the students and how it impacts it in so many ways. And the idea behind this is that we have to train our staff too, so that our staff understand what kind of effect this is having on our students. And it's certainly what kind of staff education we need to give and talk about as it relates to knowing more about the impact that this disease has had on various different groups of people. And so that's just something I want to mention. Again, I'm not sure I was very clear on that, but I was really talking about parent communication, parent understanding, and now I'm also talking about staff understanding, our own understanding of how we can do better when we have situations that because of the impacts that COVID has had on so much of our population and our different populations, what that's doing to our students. So
thank you
some
so
mental
much.
Health issues as well there.
Trustee Harrison, did you want to add anything before we wrap up for the evening? Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. I just wanted to say thank you to the staff for making this a priority, and thank you to the parents and community members for joining. I hope to see more of this. We've asked for two-way communication and you all delivered, and I hope that we'll continue to grow in this way and in this effort. So thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Presley, you get the last word.
I'll echo Trustee Harrison. I appreciate everybody's interest in this and joining us tonight. With the pandemic, there are a lot more questions than answers. I can tell you our staff is working really, really hard with the support of our trustees to make sure we're providing the best experience possible and keeping everybody as safe as possible. So I really thank everybody for joining tonight, and hopefully you got some questions answered, but we still have questions every day as we continue to navigate. So thanks to everybody who joined the call tonight.
And I'll just add a reminder that the information about our next two town halls for coming up next week on Monday and Tuesday is available on our website. You can register for those. Again, you can email communityrelations@roundrockisd.org if you feel like there's some more information we need to be putting out there. This will be recorded and on our website, so you can share it with your friends. Thank you so much for joining us.